Biggest problem of all, because people have to understand about the immune system. They want to make it so special, like, oh, it's not a flu. It's more than a flu. It's a flu, period. That's what it's about. Every year, about 0.1% of the population will die from the annual flu every year. And I say, well, what about this year? And they go, oh my God, the 3 to 4%, which is like 30 or 40 times more lethal. I go, wait a minute, where'd you get that statistic? The way you get the statistic is you take the number of people who died and divide it by the number of people who have the virus. I go, okay. So I said, well, what's wrong here? And I'll tell you what's wrong is when they've tested like a whole city, like in Italy, in Vo, Italy, for example, they tested the population and they found that more than half of the people that have the so-called COVID-19 virus, more than half of them have no symptoms at all. I say, so why is that relevant? I say, if you take all the people who have the virus, whether they have no symptoms or whether they have symptoms, that's a very large number compared to the number of people who went to the doctor and got reported to have a virus. So I say, why is it relevant? I say, if you take the very large number of people who have been exposed and who have that virus, and then divide that into the number of deaths, guess what? It's not 3 to 4% at all. It's below 1%. I go, well, now you're in the range of a normal flu. And I go, well, yeah, exactly. But the fear that has been generated by this is the biggest problem of all, because people have to understand about the immune system. The immune system is designed for internal protection. Anything that gets in my body, parasites, viruses, bacteria, the immune system's function is to fight that. And I say, does it use energy to have the immune system? I go, of course. If you've ever been really sick, you probably didn't have enough energy to get out of bed sometimes. I say, the immune system uses lots of energy. I go, so what? Well, then here comes the problem. There are two protection systems. The immune system protects me on the inside. The adrenal system, which is called fight or flight, protects me from threats on the outside. I go, so why is it relevant? Let's give a scenario here. You have a bacterial infection. You might have a bad case of diarrhea coming, and you're being chased by a saber-toothed tiger. Question, if I had to divide the energy in my body to protect me from the flu or bacteria and from the tiger, how would you split the energy distribution between those two? And Brian, this is really relevant. I mean, ask you, if you're being chased by a tiger, you got a flu, what proportion of the energy of your body do you want to use to run away from the tiger? And what proportion do you want to use to fight the bacteria? It's a pretty clear answer. I hope you see it.
Probably 99-1 is probably what I would
say. Exactly. So right away, that's the fundamental principle. Fundamental principle is this. I distribute energy in the body where I need the energy. And when it comes to threats and survival, if it's a threat from the outside world, I need to put all the energy into that. I say, how does this work? When we perceive a threat, when we believe and perceive that we're being chased by that saber-toothed tiger, the body releases stress hormones. I go, yeah, so what? That gets me ready. I say, gets you ready for fight or flight. I said, what does it do to get you ready? And this is the crux of the problem. What the stress hormones do is take the energy of the body, stop funding with energy those functions that are not necessary to run away from the tiger. Because what you want to do is you want to get all the energy possible into the arms and legs, which is the blood. The blood carries the energy. Why? Because I need to run away from that tiger. So what happens when stress hormones are released in the body? And the first thing is this, all functions not related to running away from that tiger are shut down to conserve the energy. When stress hormones are released into the body, they cause the blood vessels in the gut to squeeze shut. Why? And the answer is, if the blood vessels squeeze shut, then the blood is pushed to the periphery, the arms and legs. The blood is, in scientific terms, preferentially sent to the arms and legs at the expense of what? Shutting the blood vessels in the gut. And that's when people get the butterflies in the stomach. When they start to get scared, they can feel a little queasy going on. And I say, what is that? I say, that's the action of stress hormones causing your blood vessels in the gut to squeeze shut, so you push the blood to the arms and legs to deal with fight or flight. So the first thing is this, when you're in fear, you shut down the growth and maintenance of the body. It's very simple. Why should I fund those things if the tiger's chasing me? If the tiger catches me, then maintenance of the body is not my problem anymore. And I go, okay, that shuts down my growth as I get ready for protection. I go, yeah. And here's the other fact, and this is the one that's relevant. The immune system, as I said, uses so much energy that when it's engaged, we may be so depleted of energy, we don't have any energy to get out of bed. Fact of life, this is it. Stress hormones shut down the immune system to conserve energy so I can run away from the threat. And I go, it's so powerful at shutting down the immune system that stress hormones are used, listen, therapeutically. I go, what do you mean? If I am going to transplant an organ from one person to another, the recipient of that transplant, their immune system, by definition, is going to try and reject the transplant because it's foreign tissue. What do doctors do before they transplant an organ? I say, they give the patient stress hormones, because when they get the stress hormones, it inhibits the immune function from rejecting the graft. So what's the point? My God, stress hormones are so effective at shutting down the immune system that they use it therapeutically to stop the function of that immune system. So I go, so why is it relevant? I go, because we're put into fear. Everybody who listens is now afraid. I can talk about the natural reason. If the flu is coming, we want to have people take care of themselves. But with the idea of attaching to that flu, a fear of rampant death, that changes me from last year, like, oh, I can get the flu. I get the flu every year. I cough, I sneeze, I'm okay. Everything's great. This year, oh my God, if I get the flu, I'm gonna die. That is a profound change on the physiology of any listener who listens to that. So let's look at it historically. You say, wow, that's really detrimental to the system if the stress hormones are going to shut down growth and they're going to shut down the immune system. Well, that's a terrible design. And I go, when the system was designed, the only fears that we had was to run away from the saber-toothed tiger. Once you run away from that tiger, there's no more fear. I go, so fear was only used for a very short interval of escape. And I say, and what about today? And I go, today fear is 24/7, 365. The system was never designed for prolonged fear and stress as we are experiencing in today's world. The concept of the fear is all it takes to shut down the immune system. Is everybody affected by this? And I say, look, when we were afraid because high power, high tension lines, the ones that carry the big load of electricity, and people live underneath those lines, is there any difference in the health of people who live under the high power tension lines? They find out, yeah, for sure, people are affected. You got more health issues of people living there. Is everybody affected? And this is where it comes down to the important part. No, not everybody was affected. Those that were affected were already under stress. So stress exacerbated the problem. Those people who weren't under stress living under these lines have no problem. So stress is opening up our system from attack, from anything, from electromagnetic fields to viruses. And we have to understand that stress is the bigger problem in the immune system. And this is the biggest problem that we have to face is, what is your consciousness? Because your consciousness is going to control the fate of your biology. And then you go, wow. And I go, that's the new science of epigenetics, number one. I think the most important fact, and it's really hard for people to take this fact in, but it's a fact of science. And that is this: the most valid science on planet Earth is called quantum physics. There is no science that has been tested more, affirmed more, proven to be more truthful than quantum physics, the most truthful science on the planet. So if you're going to question a science, the last one you would question is quantum physics. I go, so what's relevant? The first principle of quantum physics is consciousness is creating your life experience. The biology we just talked about is the interface of how consciousness controls the chemistry from the brain, which controls your life experiences, your genetics, your behavior, and the character of your life. And I say, why is it relevant? Because the first principle as a fact is we are creating our life experiences with our consciousness. And then the question is, where are you getting your consciousness from? What information are you putting in there? Because that information will be translated directly into your biology. And all of a sudden I say, well, we're sure as heck not given, hey, things are okay. We're being told we're all gonna die. And I go, whoa, put that picture in your mind and let me know what kind of chemistry is coming out of your brain. Well, I can tell you stress hormones and cytokines. And this is where the problem is coming from.
How do we deal with that stress? That's the big question.
The first straightforward advice is this. We have to maintain our physiology and our health. And so basically I say, well, how do you do that? And I go, you know, it's not that difficult. The number one thing is this. First of all, eat food that is good for you. Not industrial farm, but organic, natural, healthy food. Industrial farm food is loaded with chemicals that influence our system in a very negative way. Look at a farmer out there in those industrial farms spraying the crops. They're all wearing hazard suits. I go, my God, they're spraying my food and they can't be in the field with the spray because it's toxic and they're putting it on the food. I mean, just there's something to think about in that picture right there. Taking care of your nutrition, number one, is important because we nourish ourselves. And if you shorten the supply of nourishment, of course, you're going to be open to sickness. Number two is to take advantage of vitamins and supplements and things to support us because our food isn't that great. Anything we can do outside to enhance our immune system, and let me just add, especially vitamin C, when we support ourselves that way, we strengthen the immune system. And then third thing, watch what you're thinking. Because the moment you are thinking of stressful things like, oh my God, I'm not working for weeks and I'm my job, my salary, do I have any money? Fear comes from that. Can I pay the rent? Fear comes from that. Am I gonna die? Of course, fear comes from that. And I go, these fears are the primary things that inhibit the function of the immune system. You wanna stay well? Norman Cousins, who healed himself from a lethal disease, healed himself by what? He locked himself in a hotel room and got all kinds of comedies, Marx Brothers and things like that. And what did he do? He just sat there and enjoyed life and laughed and did all that. And he overcame an illness that should have killed him. This is an example of what is so important. If we do not focus on the problems that they keep throwing at us, and you start to look at your life and say, am I okay? Yeah, I'm pretty good. How's my family? We're good, we're healthy, even if there's a flu, as I said, half the people tested with the flu don't even have symptoms. So it's not as lethal as they say. It's the fear of death is the problem that we must deal with today. And the idea is, am I open to die? And I say, everybody's open to die, but will you die from this flu? I go, not necessarily unless you're part of that same group. So let me just emphasize, the group that should be concerned are the aged people, very old, people on support, like nursing support, like especially in nursing homes, people whose immune system is already compromised. If you are in that situation, then by all means, do everything to protect yourself. Isolate from those people that may be carrying it and follow the guidelines of eating well, vitamins, supplements and thinking in a different way, more specifically for that group than for the rest, because that's the group that is primarily affected by this. Then I say, yeah, but there's a lot of respiratory distress. And I go, again, all of that is manageable if you can get hospital care, if you can get a ventilator, if you can get some antiviral drugs and the medical system, people won't die from this if they get care. So basically, it's not, oh my God, I got the flu, I'm gonna die. This is, we got to change that visual picture because that is the biggest problem affecting us today is the fear.